All right, so 2-2, we're going to look a lot at different polynomial functions of higher degrees than just two. So yesterday we were looking at quadratics. Today it could be anything. So let's look at what is a continuous function. Do you notice that this is spelled wrong?
Yes.
Oh, gosh, that drives me nuts. That was Mr. Gleason. So continuous, there you go. If that bothers you, fix it. So this is what a continuous function might look like.
I think you did it wrong again.
Yeah, O-U-S.
It's U-O-U-S.
It's U, oh, shucks. U-O-C, I can't even deal
with it. U-O-U-S, there you go, us.
Good ahead.
It's the end of the day.
Mistake one for the week, are you happy? What, have we counted this week? Is this mistake two?
It's a two-day week, so.
Yeah, what did I do yesterday?
What was my mistake yesterday?
You did something.
Oh, I did something. Oh, up here I forgot my negative.
Yeah.
Okay, mistake two. Thanks. Thanks for keeping track. Well, it could even be really funky looking like this. You can have dips in it. I mean, it can look very strange. But notice, they have continuous. I just want you to notice I spelled it right. Continuous curves. They are smooth, rounded graphs. So I'm going to show you some on the right that are not continuous. You can kind of have something with which to compare it with. So over here we're going to put non-continuous. So let's say, and you've loved these in the past, some of you, several of you, did them wrong on your test. So you might have something like this. Even though that's a function, would you agree that it's a function?
Mm-hmm.
It is non-continuous because it does not have a continuous path. There is a break in the path where you kind of have to jump from one point to the other right here, isn't it? Oh, well, I just unprettied my picture. But that's a break in the path right there, isn't it? Okay, prior to the smudge, that was a break in the path, wasn't it?
Sure.
Just there to abuse you. It's a smudge.
Just there to irritate you.
You have no idea how much I want to redo that. Not going to happen. All right, so then what about this? Good so far, right? Good so far. Boop. Looks like a tennis ball bounced on the ground and went up, right? This sharp turn right there makes it, it's continuous, but it doesn't have a smooth round curve. So in conclusion, you may have no sharp turns. Whoops, turns, or a piecewise, which is the graph above. So let's look at several graphs up here. So I'm going to put up some, and you might want your calculator. Does anybody need a calculator? Will you go grab them out of my desk drawer? Who else needs a calculator? Two, I need two, Noelle. Anybody else need one? Three, just bring all three from my drawer. One of these days I'm going to sit and I'm going to miss my chair. That will not be good.
It'll be interesting.
No, I'll be hurt. I'll be desperately hurt. All right, so let's start with, we know x squared, right? Y equals x squared. Oh, don't worry about it. Oh, I'm going to trust you guys. I can keep track of three. So, for this one, if I did y equals x squared, I would have a point at 1, 1, negative 1, 1, 2, 4, and negative 2, 4. Agreed? This is x squared. We're going to look at the difference between odd and even degreed functions. Would you agree that that is an even degree? Right? So this is even. Okay. What happens if I start upping, ramping up the degree? So in my calculator, I want you to go ahead and put into y equals, I want you to put in x squared. Oops, that would be the wrong one. How about x squared? And then right below it in the next y equals, I want you to put in x to the fourth. Just for right now. Then I want you to hit graph. And you should hopefully have a standard viewing window. And two graphs should occur. There's the second one. Now, if I have x to the fourth, look what's happening here. See how that's kind of flattening right there? And it's getting closer to the y-axis, isn't it? So let's go ahead and try to graph x to the fourth. It's going to be hard to keep, the higher I move up my exponents, the harder it's going to be to actually have real points on there. So I'm going to use a different color. I still have 0, 0, wouldn't you agree? Mm-hmm. But this time, if I have x to the fourth, what's 1 to the fourth? 1. So I still have this point in common and this point in common, but instead, what if I had, take your calculator, oh, it probably won't give you, let's see what it gives you. Your table isn't going to be on there. On the green graph, what is 1 half squared? 1 fourth, okay? For my new graph, x to the fourth, what is 1 half to the fourth? 1/16. So is that closer to the x-axis or further away?
Closer.
Closer. So that's why you see this flattening out right here, right? So although both graphs have 0, 0, and 1, 1, and negative 1, 1 in common, you're going to see this flattening out down here that didn't occur with the green. And then it's going to go a lot narrower up here. Because plug in 2 now. What's 2 to the 4th? 16. So you're going way up higher, so it stretches that graph closer to the y-axis, doesn't it? So this is your x to the 4th. Now what if I did x to the 6th? So let's go ahead and that's what it was before. Now we're going to put into our y equals, go down to the third one, and put in x to the 6th. What do you propose it's going to do? It's going to pull it closer to the y-axis, and what's it going to do to the x-axis? It's going to be closer to the x-axis. So, and it's really kind of hard to graph by hand, but look what's happened. So it's really close to x to the fourth, isn't it? But this is x to the sixth right here, and it's still making this flattened part right here. So again, I'm going to have really close in here, real flattened down here, really close here. So this becomes x to the sixth. Notice that all three of them, look at their end behavior. The start of the graph and the end of the graph. Aren't they both facing up? Okay. So just an observation. This is something that you might want to write down here in your notes. The greater the exponent, the flatter the graph is. From negative 1 to positive 1. And you're going to see as we go along that all the graphs will still have 1 and negative 1 in common. Same points in common as before. All right, so let's move to an odd function. So let's do an odd. So my lowest odd function other than linear would be x to the third. Agreed? Oh, and by the way, on your calculator, this will be interesting. Take away, go back to y equals, and just take away the x squared. Just the x squared. Go back to your graph. Okay, so there's the other two. Kind of really close and flat down here. Now take away the x to the fourth. And look at the graph again. See how flat it is? It looks like it's a straight line down here, isn't it? Your calculator is not capable of showing you how close it's getting to the x-axis, but not touching it. But that's why it's looking like it's getting flat down there. All right, so go ahead and take that out too. And then go back to y sub 1. This time I want you to put in x cubed. And just look at the graph. This is something we've graphed before, right? Looks like a funky looking x. What point is this?
2, 3, 2.
And what point is this right here? 1, 1 and 1, -1. So those are the critical values, so to speak. X cubed. So I've got 0, 0, I have 1, 1. And 1, -1. These are going to be the same points that you're going to see in common no matter what exponent I put. So look at how far away from the y-axis it is. So if I put 2 in there, what's 2 to the third power? 8. So I've got 2. I'm going to go up. So that might be here. And then negative 2 would be negative 8, right? So my graph is going to look something like this, and this is x cubed. Now we're going to raise the exponent. As we raise the exponent, what do we expect to happen? It's going to get flatter between negative 1 and 1. Because think about this, if I raise the exponent to x to the fifth, it's going to have the same shape. But now think of in terms of in between here, try 1/2. What would be 1/2 to the fifth power? What's 2 to the fifth? 2 to the fifth is 32. Get used to it. You use it a lot. What is 2 to the third? So 1/2 to the third was 8, right? So 1/2 to the third, isn't that 1/8? Versus 1/2 to the fifth. Now we're talking 1/32. You see how it quickly starts to flatten? So as I look at x to the fifth, let's plug it in here so you can see the change in graph. So x to the fifth, and then hit graph. So now it's showing not much change in here, right? And it is actually closer to the y-axis, just like with the even function. They still have these points in common, though. And here's where the difference starts to come into play. I get closer down here, closer up there, and then come back down here. So this is x to the fifth. So it's starting to flatten out right there. And then put in, what's the next one? X to the seventh. Now we can hardly even see the difference, right? But now it's getting really flat there. So the higher we get, the closer they're going to be to each other. But again, they're all still going to have those three points in common.
but it starts to create this horizontal line down there. So I have x to the 7.
What do you notice about the end behavior of the odd functions? One goes in one direction, one goes in the opposite direction. Somebody who's odd can't figure out what direction they're going to go. I think I'll go this way today. Maybe I'll go that way today. You can think of it in terms of that. All right, so here I would like you to note that all these graphs have 1, 1, and negative 1. Negative 1 in common. Common, there we go. So on this one, they would have had 1, 1, and negative 1, positive 1 in common, right? So all the graphs still have some key points in common, especially when we plug in 1. Because your 1's are either going to be positive or negative. It doesn't matter how many times I square it, cube it, take it to the 7th power. You know, if I have an even function, won't 1 always be positive? If I have an odd function, sometimes 1's going to be positive, sometimes it's going to be negative. And that's how it creates that end function that goes in opposite directions. All right, then the next thing I want you to look at, so put a line through here. I'm going to separate this. Let's look at this graph here. F of x is equal to negative x to the 5th. What do you expect the shape of the graph to look like? First of all, a U or an S? An S. What does the negative have to do with it? It reflects it over where? The x-axis. So if you look at this red graph over here, won't it look like the red graph here, but it'll be flipped? So this red here, if we flip it, won't it go like this? And this red here, if we flip it, won't it go like this? So it's going to look like this, going in that opposite direction. So a couple things that you can do. So here's one thing that I will do. Oftentimes, and it just depends on if I'm doing it by hand or with my calculator. So let's assume that we're doing it by hand. I know that the normal x to the 5th graph has 0, 0 as a point, right? And it has 1, 1, and 1, negative 1 as a point, correct? And I am not going to be a stickler about how close it is to the x-axis, how far away. I'm really not going to be. So I'm going to put just a dotted line here because that's not really the graph that I'm graphing. This is my just plain x to the 5th. We want to do, the only shift that is going on here is a reflection down. Some of you use the word flip. Quit. I didn't mark you off for it this time, but I will. So you're going to have to use the word reflect over x-axis, which means down. So from here, I know, okay, it's going to look like, if that's the point in common, wouldn't this be the point it now has? Isn't that the reflection of that point across the x-axis? Right? And for here, the reflection of this point across the x-axis would be up here. So now I can easily go, oh, here we go. Here is negative x to the 5th. So if you draw the original common function and then you perform your shifts, it's a lot easier. So you might have several graphs on one graph. Just make sure that the graph that is the final graph is obvious. All right, so look at this one. Tell me what's happening here. F of x is equal to x to the 4th plus 1. What does its common graph look like? A parabola, parabolic, right, looking. And then what's its shift or its transformation? What'd you say? Up 1. 1 is outside the argument, isn't it? So if I were you, I would draw the common points that they all have in common. So all of the parabolas, squares, fourths, sixths, they all have 0, 0, and they have 1, 1 in common, and negative 1, positive 1 in common. So no matter how close to the y-axis this might become, and we're just going to say that that's x to the 4th, to shift it, I'm going to shift up one. Shift all three of these points up one. So here's this one goes up one, and this one goes up one. And now I can just fill in my graph. And now this is x to the fourth plus one. Some of you might not need to do that. And you definitely won't have your calculator available on some of these questions to do that. There will be a calculator portion of your test and a non-calculator portion. So if I were you, I'd practice doing it without your calc. Can you check it on your calculator? Absolutely, of course, because you're at home. All right, so then look at example three. Here we have leading coefficient tests. They will dictate right and left-hand behaviors of a graph. So I'm going to split this into two. Let's say that I have the following, and it might look like this. And the middle of your graph can be all kinds of different things. It could be a parabola, it could be a W. But the important part is your left and right hand behavior. So I could have not had any of this W stuff going on here. I could have just had a parabola. But what's important is what's happening at the beginning and the end of your graph. What kind of parabola opens up? How do you know when a parabola opens up?
When what's positive?
A, right? So A is the leading coefficient of a parabola, correct? Well, a parabola is a x squared, correct? But we might have x to the fourth. So whatever the leading or the highest degree term is, its coefficient is called your leading coefficient. So that's what we're going to call A. So when the leading is, and in this case, positive, in other words, A is greater than zero, here's the words that you're going to use. If I can get that up there. Isn't the left-hand side rising? And isn't the right-hand side rising? So it is, it rises to the left, and it rises to the right. And this is purely, on this particular side here is purely when the highest degree is even. All right, so if the coefficient is negative, leading coefficient is negative, what does the graph tend to do for even? It goes down, right? It opens down. So it might look like this. It might be a parabola, or it could be a W. But again, what's important is the end behaviors. So what is the left doing? It's not rising. What is it doing? Falling. We're going to say falling. So this is falling to the left, and it is falling to the right. Whoops. How's that? Falling to the left, falling to the right. Well, what happens when our highest degree is odd? Yes, they go in the opposite direction. This one requires a little bit more thought on your part because you're going to have to memorize what direction which side goes. It's easy for the evens because they're either up or down, and that's easy to tell when A is positive or negative. All right, so down below. When the leading coefficient
is.
We're going to look at positive versus negative. So let's just think about x cubed. What was the original x cubed? Where did it go up? On the right side or the left side? Above. Look above here. Right there. Isn't that regular x cubed? Isn't it rising on the right but falling on the left? That's when it's your leading coefficient is positive. So it could look, it doesn't have to necessarily look like an S. It's important what the end behavior looks like. So it might look like this. Right? That's slightly different looking, isn't it? But what's most important is your end behavior. It is falling on the left or falling to the left. But it's rising to the right. That's how you're going to describe that end behavior. If the leading coefficient is negative, doesn't it reflect that graph over the x-axis? So just like we did in this example right here, when we had negative x to the fifth, isn't the left side rising and the right side falling? All right. So again, you could have a funky looking graph here. It could look like a W sort of. But what's important is the end behavior. So on the left, it is rising. So rising to the left, but it is falling to the right. You want to think of this right here as it always mimics f of x equals x cubed. Somehow, I mean, you could have a bunch of curves and whatnot in the middle, but it is going to mimic that f of x equals x cubed. Yes?
Why do your graphs send up partially dotted?
Because this could change in the middle. It could be an S like our normal x cubed graph. That's why I'm saying it mimics x cubed. You can do anything it wants to in the middle. It's the end behavior that tells you whether it's an odd function or an even function. Odd functions, end behaviors always go in opposite directions. They might not always look like an S. And so that's why I wanted to show you that one, because it might look funky. And as you go through and put things on your calculator, you'll see that some of them are really weird and different. All right, so flip that. Any questions on that before we look at the back? Yes.
If you don't have a calculator, do you have to zoom out for some of them?
You might have to, so you can see the end behavior. Yep. Because what happens is you might only see this part on the calculator, and you might think they're both going down if you don't look wide enough. So it's possible. But if you know that that its highest degree exponent is 3, let's say, you should know your end behavior is going in opposite direction, so you should know whether you have to zoom in or out. Yes?
Is that minus x to the
cube? This one here?
Yeah.
Yes. That's when you're, so this would be negative x cubed, let's say. All right, so let's flip it. And let's talk about zeros. So zeros, whenever you're asked to find a zero, you are being asked to find, and your calculator under the calc menu has a zero feature. And what it's asking, or what you're asking it to find, is where the graph crosses the x-axis. We can do it by algebra or by looking at a graph. And I think, since I only have 3 minutes left, I am going to stop here. Now, having said that, your assignment, some things on your assignment, so listen, don't peck up, stop and listen. Some things on your assignment you won't be able to do tonight. I didn't know how far that I would get. So do everything that you can, but if it talks about finding zeros or if it talks, stop packing up. You'll have plenty of time. If it talks about zeros or if it talks about finding a polynomial function given a zero or if it talks about the intermediate value theorem, anything about zeros, don't do that question yet. We will do it after our little break.